What are the applications of Hayah? The most important application of Hayah is your Hayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there is Hayah is either towards Allah, you manifest the Hayah, exercise Hayah towards Allah, you exercise Hayah towards the Khalq, you exercise Hayah towards yourself. So when you exercise Hayah towards Allah, the Prophet said, استحيوا من الله حق الحياة. Which means what? Which means shy away from Allah as he should be shied away from. That's the, I guess, not the best translation that comes to mind, though. As he deserves. Then the Sahaba رضي الله عليهم said to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن لنستحي من الله. By Allah, the Messenger of Allah, we do shy away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, ليس ذا ولكن الحياء من الله أن تحفظ الرأس ما وضعها والبطن وما حام وتذكر الموت والدبر. وإذا أردت الآخرة ومن أراد الآخرة ترك زينة الدنيا. وإذا أردت الآخرة ترك زينة الدنيا. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, shy away from Allah as you should shy away from him. And he said to him, we shy away from Allah, Messenger of Allah. And he said to them, this is not what I am talking about. Shying away from Allah as he deserves is by safeguarding الرأس والمواه, the head and what it contains, والبطن وما حوى, and the stomach and what it contains also. وع and حوى would be quite similar. And the stomach and what it contains. والتذكر الموت والبلى, and to remember death and بلى, to remember the various afflictions. Al-Bala, it is from Al-Bala. To remember Al-Bala, to remember the afflictions that await you. وَمَنْ أَرَادَ الْآخِرَةِ تَرَكَ زِينَةِ الدُّنْيَا. And he who wants Al-Akhirah should abandon زِينَةِ الدُّنْيَا. The adornment of the dunya, the enjoyments of the dunya. But not all of the enjoyments of the dunya. Not all of the enjoyments of the dunya. Because we have to understand these hadith and ayat collectively, together. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُبْ مَنْ حَرَّمَ زِيَنَةَ اللَّهِ الَّتِي أَخْرَ لَيَرْجَ عِبَادِ عِبَادِ. Say, who forbade the zina of Allah that he brought forth for his servants. So not all the enjoyments, not all the beauty in the dunya is to be abandoned. But what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means here is to abandon excessive enjoyments of the dunya, and to abandon each and every enjoyment that will keep you back, will keep you behind, will slow you down. If you really want the akhirah, abandon all the enjoyments that will slow you down. If it does not slow you down, then it's an enjoyment of Allah made permissible for you, and Allah wants you to enjoy it. Allah wants you to enjoy it. But if it slows you down, and that's the difference. Whenever you hear, there is no conflict between the ayat of Allah and the hadith of the Prophet, or the hadith of the Prophet and themselves. No conflict. It's just that we need to understand them correctly. So whenever you hear about enjoying the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and how Allah said, say whoever made forbidden the zina, the enjoyments that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought forth for his servants, all of this talk about those enjoyments being halal and permissible for us, and there is no condemnation of enjoying these enjoyments, enjoying life in such a way. All of these talk about the enjoyments that will not slow you down. The enjoyments that will slow you down are disliked. The enjoyments that will keep you back are forbidden. Keep you back from taqwa Allah, keep you back from observing the commands and prohibitions of Allah, those enjoyments are forbidden. But beyond those enjoyments that are forbidden, there are enjoyments that are disliked, such as what? You know, give me examples, like we're talking about forbidden enjoyments, halal enjoyments. Give me examples. Disliked, forbidden, halal examples. Playing cards is disliked. No, I'm talking about, no. You actually went into haram enjoyments. This is not what we're talking about. The Prophet is not talking about this now. He wants the akhirah, leaves out the zina of the dunya. He's not talking about this now, he's talking about the halal enjoyments.
Too much sports,
everybody, soccer is like a big thing, it's coming out from this side, soccer is sports. So, playing soccer, if you miss your prayer, it's haram, right? Playing soccer, if you will miss your routine wind of azkar, of sunnah prayers, of your wind of reviewing the Quran, you have your wind, the word we should all know, wind is your routine. And there is the wind of zikr, the remembrance, wind of reviewing the Quran, everybody should have a routine of zikr, particularly as sabah al masa, morning and evening, and other awrad for yourself, other routine that you should observe. And you have your word of reviewing the Quran, you have your routine of reviewing the Quran. So playing soccer that will keep you away from the prayer, the obligatory prayers, playing soccer that will keep you away from the word, your routine, which is not obligatory, but your routine, is disliked. That slows you down. Slows you down, so it's disliked. Playing soccer after you have done your routine and you have done your word of this and that, and you pray that everything is permissible. Is permissible. To have a nice car, this is the same thing. You know, if you buy an expensive car and you will need to be you need to like struggle too much to maintain the car, because once people buy an expensive car, they say to themselves, we should have the house that is befitting of this car, should have the attire that is befitting of this house. You live amongst like a neighborhood, in a neighborhood that is an upscale neighborhood, so you should have the attire that is fitted. All of this is fine, as long as it's not slowing you down. It is fine to have a nice car, it's fine to have a nice house, it's fine to have, you know, nice suits and attire, as long as there are many, it's very conditional. It is fine conditionally, because there are many conditions for this to be fine. But it's not time now to go over the conditions. But I'm saying it is fine as long as you're observing the conditions. But having the car that will make you fall in haram, is haram. That enjoyment is haram. That car is haram, you know. And having the car that will slow you down, it will make you, you know, it will push you into the vicious cycle of, you know, having to earn money and like working too hard. Like the Prophet said, Himar bin Nahar Jifa bin Layl, Alim, Himar bin Nahar Jifa bin Layl, a donkey during the day. The Prophet, this hadith is reported by Ahmad and his Musnad, authentically about the hateful person in the sight of Allah. And of the characteristics is that he is Himar bin Nahar Jifa bin Layl, a donkey during the day, working too hard during the day like a donkey, Jifa bin Layl, like a dead piece of meat at night. So basically, his work keeps him away from the worship of Allah, keeps him away from, you know, the various acts of worship, and he is completely dead at night. So the car that will push you into this is dislike, that enjoyment is dislike. It's not making you do something that's haram, but it's keeping you from your awrad, it's keeping you from your ibadah, it's keeping you from what you need to do, you know, to moisten your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then it becomes this light. I know that some people will come back and tell me, but we need to be a strong nation, we need to work hard. This is not against working hard. This is not against your work ethics. Because working hard and perfecting your work and being a master at what you do is, you know, part and parcel of Islam. It is, but this does not necessarily mean that you will ignore. In fact, you know, most of the successful people are balanced people. You know, success comes with balance. To be balanced between the rights of Allah, you know, your spiritual dimension and your physical dimension, rights of Allah, rights of the family, rights of your body, rights of... It is being balanced that comes about with success, that brings about success. So this is not against being a strong nation and being an advanced nation and being technologically, you know, this and that and working hard and getting ahead of everybody else and showing that we as Muslims are not airheads. We actually do have brains and so on and so forth. But it is important that all of this is not keeping us away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from our commitments towards Allah. So to shy away from Allah, to show haya to Allah, to exercise haya towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He deserves, is to safeguard the head and what it contains. Safeguard your head and what it contains. It contains your thoughts, contains your vision, contains your hearing. So to safeguard all of this from that which Allah dislikes. From that which Allah dislikes. To safeguard the stomach and what it contains. And the scholar said that what it contains also includes the farj, the sexual parts. So to safeguard all of this. وَلْتَذْكُرَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْدِلَةِ And to remember death and afflictions. وَمَنْ أَرَابَ الْآخِرَةِ تَرَكَ زِينَةَ الدُّنْيَا And he who truly wants the akhirah, the hereafter, must abandon some of the enjoyments, some must abandon. Literally, the hadith says, must abandon the enjoyments of the dunya. But we said what Allah means here, what the Prophet ﷺ meant in this hadith, must abandon those enjoyments of the dunya that will slow you down from the pleasure of Allah and from the attainment of the highest reward of al-akhirah. That is what haya means from Allah. So that is a haya from Allah, and then a haya from the people, haya, exercising haya towards the people, and that should be understood. Exercising haya towards yourself, meaning that you should be too shy, to catch yourself doing something that is inferior, something that is beneath your status. Even if you are alone, in the middle of nowhere, You're too shy to catch yourself doing something that is inferior, something that is unbecoming of a believer of a high status. And that could be like too many things. Remember when we were in Atikaf and we talked about some examples of things that are completely halal, things that are completely halal, but they would compromise your integrity as a believer. They would start to make scratches, even if they make little scratches in the first line of defense, which is the line of defense of al-haya. We didn't get into the second line of defense, which is al-amana, or the third line of defense, which is al-rahman. But those things, if they make little scratches in the first line of defense, as a believing person that wants survival, that wants salvation, that wants Allah to accept him and to be pleased with him, you should not allow yourself to scratch the first barrier. And that is when we talk about integrity, you know, being in your full integrity, in watching anything that, like, for example, to laugh in a manner that is unbecoming of a believer. That is
you know, scratching the barrier. So they laugh loudly. You're scratching the barrier because it's unbecoming of the believer. Have you ever heard of the Prophet ﷺ? He never laughed, you know, until you see the back of his back teeth. Demo is my problem. But to laugh out loud, too loud, you know, is unbecoming. Now, if you tell me, produce a proof from the Quran and Sunnah that this is haram, I will tell you it's not haram. I am not telling you it is haram. But I am telling you that the Prophet ﷺ said, if you feel no shame, do as you wish. And I'm telling you that this is the first barrier. And I'm telling you that the scholars, in order for them to enforce that first barrier, they did so much to enforce that first barrier. So to sit down with your legs stretched in halaqa al-zikr or ilm, in halaqa al-zikr or ilm, to sit down with your legs stretched, the scholars consider this to be huge. This, you know, like no one in his right mind would sit down like this in halaqa al-ilm, you know, or zikr. So you sit down in the proper way, jilsat al-muta'amal, or al-kurfusa, like this or this, some proper way. Now, did anyone say that sitting with your legs stretched like this is haram? No one of the scholars said that. But they said that this actually compromises khawarim al-wudu', things that compromise your integrity, things that make scratches in that first barrier. And you don't have guarantees. If you could continue to scratch the first barrier, you could end up having a hole in the first barrier. And then the shaitan can proceed to the second barrier, the barrier of amana, your religious commitments. So examples, passing wind, for instance, some people do this. And this may not be particularly about, you know, amongst the mischief-going people, this may not be known. But some people consider it funny, for instance. You know, in high school, you went to high school here in America. So some people would consider it to be like, so what? I don't care. You pass wind in the presence of people. And although I will not be able to produce, the Prophet ﷺ, whatever hadith that talk about this are not clear. So the Prophet ﷺ, for instance, one time said, مَدَرْ أَحَدِكُمْ يَضْحَكُ مِمَّا يَفْعَلْ. It is reported by Bukhari Muslim that someone passed wind and then they laughed. And then he said, why do you laugh at what you do? But he said, what you do. He did not say the haram that you do. He said, why are you laughing about what you do? And he did not mention it, you know, did not mention what it is that you do. He said, نَبَرْ أَحَدِكُمْ يَضْحَكُ مِمَّا يَفْعَلُ. So why do you laugh about what you do? And he didn't even mention what they did. So this hadith, you could never say, no one in his right mind could ever say that this hadith means it's haram. But does this compromise the integrity? It does compromise the integrity. This is an example that you could relate to. You know, most of the people would relate to this example. But, you know, laughing in a certain way, dressing in a certain way. If you dress, people like dress properly, decent, good looking, all of this is fine. But if you dress too cool, that will compromise your integrity, because the way, you know, what people define as cool particularly, or too cool, it compromises the integrity. You know, if it compromises your integrity to chase the different fashions they come up with every day. Chasing the different fashions they come up, every time they come up with a fashion, everybody starts to change the wardrobe. And then you buy new shoes, and you buy new pants, and you buy new shirts. You're a man. Act like a man. You're changing your wardrobe because someone in some place some street in Paris or Rome or some place came up with a new fashion, and then it caught fire, and then everybody started to dress like this, and they changed the size, and you know, then why it becomes fashionable, and everybody rushes to buy white pants. You know, and then they tighten the pants up, and then everybody rushes to tighten the pants up, and then wear tight pants. And then you do, what is happening? Basically, paying attention to this means that you have lost three quarters of your hayat. You're almost gone. It is, because that is unbecoming of a believer of complete integrity and excellent character, conduct. It is really unbecoming. So that does not mean that you will look too awkward. That does not mean that if you go to, you know, places to buy clothes, that you will have to look for things that are particularly awkward so that you're not following the fashion. But paying attention to this and chasing the fashion is khawarimuwa. You know, violators of integrity. Violators of integrity. What are the other examples? Huh? Jim? No, that is not khawarimuwa. To work out? And, bodybuilding? Why is this khawarimuwa? Oh, you're asking if it is? No, it should not be. No, because basically having, perfect bodies, good, powerful bodies is good. If you want to play Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, that's fine. It's not fun. One of the brothers have introduced me to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Is it called that?
Yeah.
Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu? No, that is not fun. So what are other examples? To chew gum for like a man of perfect character is unbefitting. Think about it. You know, if people are sitting in a meeting, for instance, at the White House, would you? I'm talking about people that are not believers in the first place in Islam. So, but would you expect them to be chewing gum in a meeting, in an important meeting? No, because it is really, but to chew gum to change the, to chew gum at times to change the odor of your mouth is not far in the world. But to chew gum inside the masjid is horrendous. This is just this is not too much. This is not causing to sit down in the masjid chewing gum. That is really, am I saying it is haram? I am not saying it is haram. But there is that barrier, that important barrier of a haya that we should not compromise. And if you scratch this barrier, you end up having a hole in that barrier, and the shaitan gets to the second barrier. What are other examples? Because examples are important. This talk, it is important to mention examples. Yes, sir. Talking to someone while using the miswak is also something that basically, when you talk to someone, give him your fullest attention. It may be, it depends on the kind of relationship that you have with this person. Because sometimes, if two people that are sitting in Atika, for instance, and they are two best friends, and they're sitting together in Atika, or they are roommates or something, and they're talking while they're using the miswak, that may not be an issue. But to talk to someone that is an elder, to talk to your teacher, your elder, someone that you don't know well, someone that you're meeting for the first time while you're using the miswak, that certainly is disrespectful. But also sometimes these issues depend on the context, the people, and circumstances. Yes. Useless speech. Useless speech is one of the biggest violators of integrity. People who do not know when to stay silent are people who are bound to error. فمن كسر كلامه من كسر خطأه.
He whose speech is, you know, excessive, his errors will be excessive. Or he who speaks a lot, errs a lot, makes a lot of errors. So, some is an indication, long periods of silence is one of your greatest indication on wisdom, integrity, and perfection of character. Those who speak less and listen more. And all of these are things that are considered to be violators of integrity, that compromise your hayat, that compromise your first barrier against the shaitan. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to endow us with fullest hayat and the greatest character. إنه على ذلك قدير كما قال علماء المسيح اللهم اغفر ذنوبنا واصلحنا في امرنا وكفر سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الابرار اللهم ارزقنا حبك وحب من يحبك وحب كل عمل يقربنا الى حبك اللهم ارزقنا الايمان اللهم حبب الينا الايمان وكره الينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان اخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاه والسلام على اشرف المرسلين سبحان ربك رب العالمين وشهد ان لا اله الا الله واستغفر الله واتوب اليه